And the senator, and then I guess Andrews can speak too.
That's what we're going to do, is ask the panelists to just sit across the back of the room for a couple minutes.
Okay, so we have to herd the cats and get them in here, I guess. You know, yeah, just kind of.
You want me to do it?
Ladies and gentlemen, if you could start to take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. We're ready to start the program.
Senator?
If the panelists could sit across the back for now, we'll call you up right after a few preliminary presentations.
How are you? Please sit in the back.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we're getting ready to start. If the panelists could sit across the back, we're going to do a couple preliminary presentations, and then we'll start the whole process. And remember, the way the cameras are set up, we can do crowd shots. So be careful what you do. So just to give you the play out this morning, there'll be some preliminary presentations from the president, from Senator Golden, a little bit on the state of the industry from the Entertainment Software Association, and then another presentation about magic and where some of the students are, and then right to the panel for our very good discussion at that point. So is everybody kind of where you want to be? Or approximately? Mr. President?
Please. Thank you, sir.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to RIT and the University's Center for Media, Arts, Games, Interaction, and Creativity. Gee, what does that spell? Also known as magic. We're so delighted to have you here for what promises to be a really informative, innovative, and productive day. You've selected the perfect venue to discuss how to grow a multi-billion dollar industry in our backyard. I'm beginning to think that maybe that isn't adventurous enough. Can the video game design and development industry be an economic engine for New York State and upstate New York? I think the question is absolutely yes. And RIT, I think, is very well positioned and ready to help drive this effort. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Senator Golden for his leadership in spearheading and hosting this roundtable, and also thank Senators Joe Robach and Pat Gallivan for their participation in this important discussion. But before we get to these specifics, I'd like to provide our visitors some pertinent information about RIT. We welcomed a record-breaking class of 2,800 freshmen to campus this fall, as well as 700 transfer students. And we're now a majority out-of-state enrollment institution. In fact, 60% of our graduate students come from more than 100 countries. And with more than 18,000 students, RIT has grown to become one of the top 15 largest private universities in the nation. And you may have heard about the brain drain, but we believe we are importing talent to New York State, and with your help, we can create more of the jobs to help keep them here when they graduate. Many of our academic programs are recognized nationally and internationally, but particularly relevant to this session today, we are one of the top schools in which to study video game design, and according to international rankings from the Princeton Review, our game design and development program ranks fourth at both the undergraduate and graduate levels. Innovation, creativity, and entrepreneurship are integral to the academic experience for students at RIT, and they carry that expertise with them into successful careers. For example, the recent Hollywood movie Life of Pi won this year's Oscar for Best Visual Effects for its lifelike incorporation of a digital Bengal tiger. Three graduates from RIT's School of Film and Animation, which is currently ranked in the top three, were part of that team that won the Academy Award. And if you've seen that movie, it's very hard to tell where the real tiger stops and the animated tiger begins. It's a hell of a job. Alex Kipman The primary inventor of the Kinect system for the Xbox 360 and Windows is an RIT grad. Alex is a Microsoft engineer who was honored as the 2012 National Inventor of the Year, and he holds more than 60 patents with Microsoft. And each year, hundreds of students show off at Imagine RIT, our Innovation and Creativity Festival. And since 2008, Imagine RIT has drawn 175,000 visitors. It has jump-started new ideas, products, services, and student-led ventures varying from strong-arm technologies, which are inventors of a lifting system that won virtually every startup business competition in the country last year, to biotelemetrics, an award-winning non-invasive heart monitoring system. And building on the spirit of innovation and entrepreneurship, we have created the Magic Center, a place where we will work with students to take their ideas to market. Digital media is changing the way we communicate, the way we learn, and the way we think. Through a wide variety of mechanisms, including traditional and non-traditional research programs, artistic production and experimentation, entrepreneurial activities, and corporate and governmental partnerships, MAGIC will act as a collaborative home for the exploration and production of digital media by the RIT academic community, with talented students leading the way. But to really capitalize on the center, we need your help and support. Each year, RIT graduates some 100 students with skills in game and media development, but most leave the area to find jobs. In 2011, a wonderful social networking company called Digsby, which was founded by RIT alums and started while they were students here, graduated from our incubator, but it was quickly acquired by a California company, Tagged, and all of its employees, of course, moved to California. We can and we must keep companies like this right here in Rochester. We know that if the jobs are available and if we can create a cluster industry to provide long-term business and career opportunities, more of these graduates will stay. RIT is already a significant economic driver in the region, but we want to do more to help the regional economy as well as the state as a whole. We are confident that initiatives such as we are talking about today are the kind of opportunities that can deliver new economic growth here in upstate New York and statewide. And now it's my pleasure to introduce New York State Senator Martin Golden. Senator Golden is chairman of the Select Committee on Science, Technology, Incubation, and Entrepreneurship. And thank you, Senator Golden, for bringing this fact-finding session to RIT. Senator Golden.
Thank you very much, William. You're doing an outstanding job here as the president, and we want to thank all of your staff for hosting and the great work they've done over the last 2 days. Please give them a round of applause, and Bill Dresta for the great work that they're doing here at RIT. Before I begin, let me say how impressed I am with the Magic Center and by RIT, and by a guy named Andy Phelps, which I think you all know. Give him a round of applause and Magic and the great work that they're doing. We have an awful lot of interesting people on these panels today, people of success, people that are going to be successful, and many of them starting out right here. And that's what's very interesting about today's forums. I understand that among the dozen largest private universities in the United States, with you here, there are just too many accolades to give or to mention. One of the achievements that I definitely have to point out is the significance of the subject today, and that's your undergraduate video game design program that was recognized by the Princeton Review as the fourth top-ranked program in the country and the second for graduate in 2012. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is a tremendous, tremendous achievement. It is one of the reasons that we've picked RIT for this roundtable. And also, let me compliment you. We have an extraordinary staff. We had a great day yesterday. We went from building to building, and believe me, I was impressed coming from the city of New York. We have 18,000 students in just one of these buildings. So it's very, very difficult coming from a great city and coming up here and seeing the greatness that is done here at RIT and the great campus that you have here. We're very, very impressed, and obviously we're also equally impressed with the staff. So welcome, everyone. My name is State Senator Marty Golden, and I am the chair of the New York State Special Committee on Science, Technology, Incubation, and Entrepreneurship. That's a long title, but it is meant to be. It is to focus what we have to focus, and that is on creating jobs here in these areas across this great state. We're fortunate in this effort to be united in a common purpose with the governor, with the Economic Development Commissioner and his agency, and with our colleagues in the state Senate and in the state assembly. And we're united for that and for a common purpose of creating that atmosphere here in the state of New York. Our committee is new, but its members include the chairs of civil service, which is myself, banks, higher education, corporations and authorities, infrastructure and capital investment and commerce, economic development, and small business. That is a very, very powerful group. It is also multi-partisan, Republicans, Democrat, and independent Democrats. And I'm joined with one of my colleagues, Senator Ted O'Brien in the back there, who will be sitting on the panel with us, and Senator Joe Robach will join us, and Senator Pat Gallivan will join us shortly. And they will be in and out because of their busy schedules through the course of the afternoon. And some of our members are here today, and they will be participating in these discussions. This past year, we created what has been called the strongest and most robust incubator program in the country. Now we are looking at the entertainment and educational gaming portion, which is a large and growing piece of the industry. If we do it right, we think that New York can claim an increasing share of the jobs and opportunities for our citizens. When we look at the statistics, we see good news and also what I call very encouraging news. You may not think when I start this off that it's as encouraging as it is. The good news is that we have about 5,500 people working in this area with a contribution of about $270 million to the state economy. The encouraging news is that we lag California, Texas, Washington in not only companies, but in employees and in economics. And you got this little state right next to us that's trying to eat our lunch. It's called Massachusetts. Little place, Boston, in that little state. And they're trying very hard to overtake us, but we're not going to let them do that. Even Texas has a contribution of 2.16, I'm sorry, California has a contribution of $2.16 billion to the state economy. Think about that. $2.16 billion compared to $270 million here in the state of New York. Even Texas has twice the economic impact and twice the number of employees than New York does. How is that encouraging? It means clearly, there's only one thing that we can do, and that's grow. And the only thing and the only way that we'll do that is by coming to RIT, going to Poly NYU, and working with the institutions across this state, working with the companies that have already been established here in the state of New York, and working with the newer companies, the young people that are here today that are formulating their companies and giving them the opportunity to stay and live, create their companies, and go to manufacturing right here in the state of New York. It means clearly that we can do and will do better. We have room for growth. New York is waking from a decade of a long sleep in many of these areas, including this one. The purpose of these roundtables is to collect the facts and the ideas from the best in the industry and the university and government and the entrepreneurs that we can create policy and program that will make us the center of the game software universe. Can we grow an industry in New York? We did it recently in movies. I created the film tax credit working with my good friend back here, and I got to give him some credit as my staff here, Bobby Herz. Give Bob Herz a round of applause. He helped us write this many years ago. When we first wrote the film tax credit, which I get a lot of grief for because it we have a downstate, upstate. We don't get enough jobs out of it upstate, and we're trying to make sure that there are enough jobs upstate. But I look at the bottom line, and the bottom line is if you're doing well in any portion of the state, that means the whole state is doing well because the bottom line is doing well. The latest version, we started off with $25 million, that tax credit. The latest version of that tax credit today is $420 million. And because we've captured a multi-billion dollar industry in this state, even people who hate the credit, that argue against the credit in other states, and admit that the only state that it has a significant impact and has a significant return on investment is the state of New York. We took an industry, we didn't go to war with California. California was a $30 billion industry. We were like a $4 billion industry. We went to war with Canada. Canada was eating our lunch, and they still are, even in this industry. We have to find a way of bringing those jobs and companies back here to the state of New York and keeping them in the state of New York. And with that film tax credit, we were able to do that and creating 140,000 jobs, not just in the city, but across this entire state. Rochester here is doing well with animation and other parts of the industry. And we're going to continue to work with that industry to grow that industry and to make it work for our state. And that's exactly the concept that we want to do, going after these credits. And we can do it again in this area. And I think when companies and entrepreneurs think of game development, we want them to think the state of New York, not Silicon Valley, not California. We want them to think the state of New York. What the hell? We want them to think Rochester. We want them right here in RIT, right? We are taking the first steps to make that happen with the people in this roundtable who are the industry, university leaders, and any entrepreneurs. There will be two roundtables today. This is one today and one this afternoon. Both will be great roundtables. We do these roundtables rather than hearings because we want to open up the conversation and the discussion. We want something more like a family dinner. We don't want you to be worried about being at a fancy dress ball or worried about breaking the fine china. We want you to be part of the roundtable, get involved, and give us the ideas. Let it soak in so that we can bring it back to our colleagues in government, that we can bring it back to our management, and we can get this solidified not only as a legislative piece, but also as something that will be genuine going forward next year in bringing dollars into this industry and incentivizing our young and our established companies to staying here. This sector is full of opportunity. I mean, we're starting to eat and sleep this industry. And I got to tell you, the more we learn about it, the more encouraged we become. The developers and the entrepreneurs, they want to stay here, but there are barriers. And that the games universe is incredibly, incredibly diverse. From standing with just a few weeks ago, Strauss Zelnick, and the same morning that he announced at the at our last roundtable that after 3 days of success, they were going to break $1 billion at noon that afternoon in Grand Theft Auto. Outstanding. Outstanding. That's a New York-based company. But there was one really sad note. He was also told me how he was moving 200 jobs to Las Vegas. Now, why? And it's up to us as a state to figure out why they're moving those 200 jobs to Las Vegas and how and why didn't we have the opportunity to keep those 200 jobs here in the state of New York. Something that we got to work at. And then I had the good fortune of being here yesterday and with a group over here and Blake Gross and his colleagues here that created Blind Horizons. And what they did, they got a simple $5,000 grant from Geneseo, and they got some legal advice. And guess what? They're creating their game, working towards creating their goals and their achievements and being successful and starting right here again in RIT. But guess what? A little bit of a problem. I understand Blake, Microsoft just grabbed them. So when you see the team starting to break up, We have to try to encourage that team to stay together, right? We got to encourage that team to work together, because when you separate the team, you separate the thoughts. I know we got Skype and we got everything else today, but it's not the same as being in the room, sitting around, talking to each other, banging out ideas, making it happen. And then there's another group here. I turned, where is that young man that created the company? It was, he gets all excited because he came up with a name of his company, and when he was in high school, he didn't think it was a great idea or a great name. Dark Winds. Where is he? Are they here? Right back here. Give them a round of applause. There's another company that started here, right? And then I don't have to tell anybody in this room about Vicarious Visions, correct? There is a company that will probably do $1 million this year, started right here, and is still part of upstate New York's economy and has no plans of going anywhere. So we got to take, just look what I mentioned here. I took a $1 billion company in downstate, a $1 billion company upstate, and two small little groups here that came together with, and they're in different levels of expertise and getting ready to introduce and work on their gaming and to bring it forward and to market it and to get it out into the world. Think about that dynamic of how do you work with the best, big money, thousands of jobs, and how do you create that energy to keep those young companies, those young bodies, those young people here in the state of New York so that we can grow them into the same companies that grew here, Vicarious or Grand Theft Auto. How do we do that? And today's roundtables will give us some insight on how we can help to do that and how we can make this possible, these dreams, for many of these young people today. But most of all, if their dreams come through, so does the dreams of the state of New York. We increase our bottom line. We become a better managed state. We have better economics here in the state of New York. And the bottom line is we create jobs across the state from Brooklyn to Buffalo. And that's important. That gamer companies and individuals are rational economic entities. They will go where it makes the most sense to be, and that's unfortunate. That's why Microsoft and some of our companies are being stolen down in California and Las Vegas. And we are losing many of our best and our brightest to these other states. People have many ideas on how to address these issues. I expect more of that conversation today. And when we have your suggestions, we will look and work with our colleagues in the legislature and governor's office to develop these good programs. And then, fair warning, we will be back to you to ask if, in fact, we hit the mark. Are we on track? Did we go off the track? And how do we get back on that track? We don't have a whole lot of time here. I believe that this is such a dynamic industry and it's changing day to day that we have to get ahead of it. We cannot be behind it. We have to get ahead of it. Boston, I'm going to give them an A for effort. But New York, I'm going to give them an A for completion, because we are going to complete the task that we set out to do, and that's to increase the ability to do business here in the state of New York, working with this industry, working right here with RIT, working right with NYU Downstate, and making sure that these opportunities are there for them and for our state. I'm not at the stage of my career and someone who wants to be involved in a pointless exercise. If we do it, I want it to work. We all want it to work. I know I speak for my colleagues in the legislature and Tim as well, and governor's office, and they want to do the good policy that works also. So thank you all for being here today. You're part of an effort to create and expand and grow something that is important not only to the state, but to the lives of many of the people that you're going to see and hear today. We will now have two presentations, one on the state industry today from Tom Fawkes of the Entertainment Software Association and one from Andy Phelps from RIT, talking about what the students are looking for, what we as a state can do to help. Tom? Thank you very, very much.
Good morning. My name is Tom Folks. I'm with the Vice President of State Government Affairs for the Entertainment Software Association. If you're not familiar with the Entertainment Software Association, you may be familiar with some of the work that we do and some of our members. We actually, many of them are household names. We actually represent the computer and video game industry in the U.S., where the trade association represents them on business issues, government affairs issues, things like that. Some of the companies that you may be familiar with, obviously Activision, Blizzard, Disney, Electronic Arts, Sony, Microsoft, Nintendo, among some of them. So we also operate the E3, which is the Electronic Entertainment Expo in Los Angeles, the largest trade show in Los Angeles, and the largest trade show for our industry in America. We also have the voters, the Video Game Voters Network, which is about 500,000 actively politically engaged voters that weigh in on important issues to the industry. So that's who we are, that's who we represent, and our mission is to help the industry succeed and grow. And you know, conversations like this, you know, today is exactly what we're trying to accomplish. And thank you to Senator Golden, and thank you to thank you to RIT for having us here today, and thank you to Bob Herz for all his work in helping, including us in this conversation. So I think everyone in this room, or many in this room, would be familiar with some of these games here. We've come a long way in 40 years. This year is the 40th anniversary of Pong. I know it hurts to say that out loud sometimes to some people, but you know, we're certainly not your father's video games. You know, today's computer and video games fuse the work of computer engineers, actors, musicians, writers, animators to create interactive entertainment experiences that engage players of all ages. You know, these are just not teenagers playing video games. This is, you know, the demographics out here are wide. You know, just as many women today are playing video games as teenage boys. Actually, I think it's more women are playing video games than teenage boys. So the industry is very, very different today. And so you can see we've got one console, one new console is out with the Wii U, two more are on the way before the end of next month, the Xbox One, the PlayStation 4, obviously a number of different things are included in these new consoles, the motion, you know, everything else that, you know, the industry had, you know, kind of stalled on as far as people sitting on their couches playing video games. Now you can see they're, you know, up and running around and dancing and doing all these things with video games. So just incredible to see what the industry has become and how much further it has to go. But we're looking here, the big numbers were no longer 40 years ago. We were considered a fad out of the toy industry. People thought that, you know, this is just something that people will get tired away and it'll go in the attic with everything else. But we continue to reinvent ourselves as an industry. Currently, $20 billion domestically, $21 billion domestically, $65 billion internationally, and we're on pace to be at $83 billion worldwide. To put that in a little bit of perspective for you, $21 billion domestically, that is larger than the movie industry, the domestic box office of the movie industry, and the entire music industry. So combined, actually. So you put those two together, and the video game industry is larger than that. And the mobile game sector continues to explode. It's an incredible, you know, we'll talk a little bit about the app economy in a minute here, but it's just amazing how you're seeing how large that is getting, and how, you know, we're on the tail end of a console cycle, a life cycle of the consoles as people are holding back and waiting for the new consoles. So we're seeing that end that right there in 2012. We expect those numbers, you know, to come back up. But you see the light area there on the top, that's actually mobile. And as you can see, it continues to grow and diversify the industry. But the consoles are still a very big part of that. And as evidenced, as the senator mentioned earlier, that the Grand Theft Auto Had the largest one-day launch, but a couple days later, I think it's broken 7 Guinness Book records as far as entertainment properties, but is the fastest grossing entertainment property in history, grossing over $1 billion in 3 days. And just to put it in perspective, those are some of the dollar amounts of some of the largest movie grossers. And not to pick on the movie industry in any way, obviously, we share a number of members with Sony and Disney and Warner Brothers that are also members of the movie industry, but it's just a testament to how large the industry is and the potential there and how much it's growing and how it's growing up as an entertainment option. Speaking of that, we talk about the app economy. I think that people think of the apps and but people don't understand how big games are within the app economy. Some of the stats here, there's 24 of the 25 top grossing apps of all time. They're games. They're games. Of the 76 of the top 100 grossing are games. So what's being done on tablets and mobile phones are games. They're the freemium type games. They're Words with Friends. They're Angry Birds. We love to tell the stories. We had dinner with the Speaker of Connecticut. I'm sorry, the Speaker of California, Speaker of the House of California, last year, and we were having dinner with him, and he said, "Listen," he goes, "I haven't played video games in a long time. I played a little in college, but it's been a while. You have to educate me." So we started telling him about the industry, and he said, "Wait, you mean Angry Birds? Oh, I play Angry Birds all the time." So we've got gamers that don't even know they're gamers. It's actually, we talked about the demographics here, 45% of gamers today are women, 29% of people over the age of 50 are playing games on their phones now. So the industry is continuing to grow up in that. And we talk about the dollars, the free version of Angry Birds grossing $1 million $1 million a month. So it's just incredible to see those type of properties continue to grow. And I'm sure some people here are familiar with Candy Crush, and how well that does as well. But we expect the overall app market to grow by $50 billion, grow to $50 billion by 2015, the mobile games will continue to lead the way there. So the entertainment software. Continues, the entertainment software industry continues to be one of the fastest growing industries in the U.S. economy. 120,000 jobs in the United States, spread over 38 states. Obviously, as Senator Golden alluded to, we've got some very high concentrations, in some areas. California being earlier, the senator said Texas. It's not really the state of Texas, it's Austin. It's just Austin. And they've done an incredible job there in growing that industry, and people looking to make decisions about where they're going to develop their next video game, Austin rises to the top of that list. There's a number of reasons for that. And with that growth is coming, a number of people are looking to get into that industry. We've seen a huge increase in the number of schools that are offering this. Obviously, RIT here and a number of schools here in New York, but 385 colleges and universities around the country are offering video game design. How many people here that are studying that told their parents that they wanted to build video games as a kid and would be laughed off? I mean, it is a very viable and successful career path today, and we're proud to be part of that discussion, and we're proud to educate people around the country about that. These jobs constitute the epicenter of the 21st century creative idea based economy, and that's what that's the message that we're trying to get out to people, that that these games are a very big deal. The senator also mentioned the Princeton Review, the top schools for video game design. We'll talk about the top five states here. New York, They boast all the ingredients for growing a dynamic and vibrant, sustainable entertainment software industry. They've got a lengthy and storied history, a robust industry design program, and an existing ecosystem of New York-based developers and video game companies. As we mentioned, Vicarious Visions, Take-Two Interactive, billion-dollar titles that are being put out by them. These are not numbers. to brush off. These are very, very important properties that are being put together. But there certainly is opportunity to grow. Currently, New York State has about 1,600 employees in the entertainment software industry. The average salary is significantly over $90,000 a year annually. The annual compensation, about 30 computer and video game companies throughout the state. And I don't have to mention everyone's familiar with the top schools here in New York. But I think there's one component that we've been talking about that is missing from New York State to keep it competitive and to help compete here. And as you can see, much like the film industry, and like the senator alluded to, how successful the New York State film industry has been, the film industry, through their incentive, other states have done that as well. We talked about Texas or Austin. Their incentive did not include, the film industry incentive did not include video games until just a couple years ago. And when it did include incentives, it grew dramatically. I think it was after they put it together in 2009, from 2009 to 2010, they added 1,700 full-time jobs and invested over $170 million. In the state of Texas, or Austin, just because of that incentive, because they were able to compete, they were able to say there is an economic value in us moving these jobs and putting these people in places that's going to help us grow our business, and they were able to create new properties and do things like that. So you can see from here the number of states out there that have gotten very competitive. That also allowed Texas to go from the number three state for video game production, jumping over Washington State, the home of Microsoft and Nintendo, to become the number two state in the country as far as video game production. So what I would say here with the incentive program, the other issue, as we were talking about, Canada, and I know that a number of companies, especially up in upstate New York, see significant competition. I mean, the incentives are 30 to 40% that they're offering to lure these jobs out of the United States. And a number of companies are doing it. A number of companies are just can't say no to that because it allows them to make the type of games that they want to make and do it successfully. So, this is some more information on the economic impact. But we really believe that incentive is the missing component here. New York State has all the other components that it needs. We were talking earlier before the program started that talent. This industry is really driven by the talent. And you see these the talent with young talent around the college and university communities, and it grows organically from here, whether it's up here, whether it's CMU in Pittsburgh, or out on the West Coast around some of those universities, or up in Washington State and in Austin as well. So you see that. It's a great opportunity and a great industry, and I really appreciate everybody giving me their time this morning, and I hope you have a great panel discussion.
I do not have to introduce this gentleman. This gentleman is very well known to everybody in this room, but I got to tell you, this room wasn't here a month ago. As a matter of fact, this room wasn't really here yesterday. So I got to tell you, the outstanding work that RIT does with its president and with Andy is unbelievable. Give him a round of applause again.
So you're sitting in the Magic Center, and... So good morning, first of all. And the first thing I want to do is again, welcome everybody. It's been kind of crazy over the summer building this facility. And so it's nice to just kind of see that the walls are up, the paint is dry, nothing is falling on your head, no one needs a hard hat. So we're thankful for that. I do want to extend an RIT welcome to Ted O'Brien. I'm glad that he could be here today. In addition to all of the other senators and dignitaries that are in the room. I want to thank our GCOM staff for everything that they've done. That whole office has been so supportive of what we're doing. I want to thank the Magic staff that actually got everything ready, and Claire in addition. And in particular, I want to thank Jen Hinton, who organized so much of this and who helped us all out. Making that happen. So thank you to all of them for everything that's going on today. And then a couple of other sort of just random shout-outs. I was sitting up very late last night editing the website for this event, and it sort of hit me that, you know, I know everybody in this room, right? That it's been my pleasure to interact with all of the friends and colleagues from all the academic institutions, the businesses, the organizations, the industry. This is in part sort of my network, and I'm so thankful to be a part of it, and so thankful for all the support that we've gotten over the years from Bill Dessler all the way down. RIT has just been a fertile ground for this, and it's been really great to do that. And I also want to thank Tona Henderson for being here, the director of the IGM program. That was my former gig, and now she's taking on the reins and doing that stuff because I'm trying to focus on what we're talking about today. And it's that important to me that I think that that's where we want to put the focus. So Magic is a really bizarre kind of university research center. It's like almost none that I could find elsewhere. We actually split it in two. Half of it is a university research center, and half of it is a for-profit company. And most people don't think of universities and for-profit companies in the same breath, and they certainly don't think of university research and for-profit companies in quite that way. And what that for-profit company is for is to help our students get a first product out the door. Because we believe that students are driven to make things. I've worked with them for a decade, and I know they're driven to make things. They come up with the craziest ideas that you ever see. And when they make something, right, the ability to put it out into the market, the ability to get feedback from the public, the ability to put it in channel, right, is one of the big barriers to helping them take that leap, all right? I talk to a lot of students that I know they want to start a business. They don't know they want to start a business yet, all right? And so that's the challenge, okay? And we believe that if we do that, that a whole bunch of other things are going to drive out of that, right? We're going to expand our research and development portfolio, but more importantly, we're going to have new studios with first-generation products. We're going to have new business for larger incubators and accelerators that exist on the periphery of RIT, right? I describe what I'm doing to some people as pre-incubation at this point, right? Because we're really trying to get them to the point where they understand they need an incubator and that they can use an accelerator to ramp up. We're looking at building density and capacity, right? To some extent, it breaks my heart that we have all these wonderful kids that come and play in our program and build all these wonderful things, and I get to see them once a year when I go out to the Game Developers Conference and have an alumni dinner in San Francisco. I don't get to see them when I go to downtown Rochester, and I want to change that, okay? And last but not least, you know, establishing the reputation of what we're doing as a digital media hub, establishing the reputation that Rochester is the creative fertile ground, all right, to do the things that we're doing, all right? We have the talent. The talent exists. You can't walk down the hallway in IGM. You can't sit in this room when it's full of students and not understand that the talent is being produced here. And it's not just being produced at RIT. It's being produced at RPI. It's being produced at Syracuse. It's being produced at Buffalo. It's being produced at NYU, right? There's more of a network of game academics producing this talent in New York than there is almost anywhere else, all right? And yet it's not an industry that we're known for. So that's what we're here today to get at. Everybody has a little postcard in their thing, but I really believe in this cycle, right? I really believe that we really have to get stuff out in front of the public in order to learn from it, and the more stuff we put out in front of the public, the more we will learn, all right? And that means not taking every student that wants to make a game and having them deal with Apple as an individual to try to negotiate that for themselves every time out of the gate. That means providing help and support, all right, and mentorship and all of the things that are key ingredients that we know and understand, and making sure that that drives that process, all right, in ways that hitherto, you know, I think a lot of game academics up to this point have been very focused on the academics. Right, because 10 years ago, nobody was doing this, all right? I remember having conversations with Lee when we were just kind of hanging out, and there were, you know, you could write on the back of the napkin the number of people in higher ed that could even say the word games and not get laughed out of the room, all right? And now, look where we are, right? So the next focus for us beyond the degree, beyond the academics, beyond the how-to, all right, is how to start a business, how to make a product, how to go to market, all of those great and wonderful challenges. So for the folks on the internet, I wanted to make sure that I had my contact information, so it's right there. You can freeze frame that, send me an email or tweet or whatever. If you're in the audience today, you can use NYMagic, all right, is our hashtag for the day, so please, you know, tweet up and get all that stuff going. I also want to thank Joe Robach, who's joining us today. So they keep coming out, you know. It's great. And I'm more excited today to hear from all the other folks in the room than listening to me talk about our stuff. And it's given me a lot of pleasure to see friends and colleagues from near and far come out. So with this, I want to welcome back Senator Golden. Let's get these panels underway, and let's start learning. Thank you.
Thank you, Randy. If the panel can come on up, please, and take their chair, and we will start this event. I want to thank my colleagues, both Senator Robach for joining me and for Ted O'Brien for joining me here this morning. Come on up, ladies and gentlemen. And as they are taking down this moving the podium, we're going to start introducing ourselves and giving our names to the audience and what we do. And if we can start, I would like to start all the way over there in my left hand, I guess to your left, my right.
Great. Thank you. And thank you for being here today. My name is Teresa Mazzullo, and I'm the CEO of Excel Partners. Excel is a seed stage venture fund that invests in technologies emerging from the communities and the universities across the upstate region. So seed, for those of you who may not be familiar with the term, means pre-revenue. So that's where we invest.
Hello, I'm Toby Saulnier. I'm founder and CEO of First Playable Productions. We're located in Troy, New York, just a couple hours to the east of here. I'm an RPI graduate, upstate New York native, grew up in Delhi, New York, and First Playable has been in existence just over 8 years. We make games for education and for kids to learn and be entertained by, and we just were recently certified as a B Corporation, which is a company that has social as well as profit impact.
Hi, I'm Blake. I'm a student here at RIT. I'm in my senior year. I started and I'm vice president of Blind Horizon Studios, which is an independent student-run company here on campus. And we do entertaining games that try to have a more serious impact.
Hi, I'm Guha Bala. I'm president and co-founder of Vicarious Visions. We're in a little north of Albany. Actually, my brother and I, we started the company in Rochester when we were in high school, back in the early 90s. And then had our first office at the RPI Business Incubator Center and have grown the business there since. Today we have a couple hundred people in Albany and we make all kinds of games. Currently we're doing Skylanders. So we had a big launch last week. We'll try and give GTA a run for its money.
Hi, my name's Colin Duty. I'm one of the founders of Darkwind Media, which is a game studio here in Rochester, New York. We created the studio out of RIT 6 years ago now. Our focus is on games for entertainment. We have a mix of game services and original IP development. We actually worked on one of the Skylanders games with you. So we try to assist other game studios in making their mobile games and their independent games and seeing them through to production.
I'm Bob, excuse me, I'm Bob Fritzinger. I'm the executive director of the technology incubator at SUNY Fredonia. Fredonia, as you know, is very well known for what it does in visual and performing arts. Therefore, my charter is to take a look at what sits at the intersection of science, technology, the arts, and business. And the implication of that is that we have businesses that either should be or will be collaborating with some of the people that I've met here today.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ken Johnson. I'm the owner and game designer at Zephyr Games, which is an independent game studio located in Westchester, New York. I'm also an RIT grad, so had the good fortune to study under Andy and Stephen Jacobs. And we're kind of a mix of educational games. It's really kind of our core. We do client services as well as some independent internal IPO, or not IPO, IP creation. And we got my start in actually Nickelodeon right after college. So it's been a lot of fun working in educational and early learning.
Hi, everyone. I'm RJ Michael. I'm currently director of games for Google. I've been in the industry for many years, since near the beginning of the industry, and I've done more than 30 years worth of work. I've spent my entire professional career in the entertainment industry, the game, computer game industry. Done 5 startups, 4 of them were successful, and I've had a lot of experience down in the trenches and hope that I can help out with this discussion.
Hi, my name is Shane Brennan. I am the head of product platform and the chief technical officer at Epix, a premium movie cable channel company. We are a partnership between MGM, Lionsgate, and Paramount. My focus here has been to increase the content depth and interactivity of an otherwise static media, and we recognize this is the way to do that.
My name is Denny DeLeo. I'm a partner at Trillium Group, a Rochester-based venture and growth capital firm. We manage 3 separate funds, have invested in a range of companies from startup and early stage through growth phase. We've worked with local academic institutions and companies to help many companies form, and we hope to be a contributor today and admire the great work that RIT is doing in this space.
Hi, I'm Jason Arena, CEO of Working Man Interactive. We have about 30 people. We're right here in Rochester, New York. Our clients are Nickelodeon and Walt Disney, so we're trying to take some of that California revenue one game at a time. We're mostly doing entertainment-based games for those clients, but we're also working on IP stuff, trying to make our own revenue. So that's where we're at right now. Thank you.
Hi. I'm Stefan Morisharmat. I'm a senior producer for Microsoft Studios. I manage our university incubation and startups program, so really excited to be here today. Thank you.
Good morning. I am Joe Robach, and want to thank RIT for putting this together, all these panelists, and Senator Golden for taking the lead on trying to promote this. And I would just say we already have a great collaboration, I think, with all our colleges and universities, but especially here with RIT in so many areas: sustainability, green technology, engineering, remanufacturing, a number of things. And certainly we'd like to see this one grow and see if there's any policy, key investment the state could make to make this. The good news is I think New York is 3rd in this technology, in the jobs associated with it. But certainly I think there's room for growth. We have great think tanks, already existing collaborations with the private. So hopefully these series of forums will help us move in the right way. And I want to put a disclaimer. I'm here in my official capacity, not because I'm known around Rochester as the game master. Not because I create them, because of my skill at playing them. I'm only kidding. I'm terrible. But thank you all for being here, and hopefully this will be a productive day. And let me end where I started, with thanking RIT for hosting this hopefully productive forum.
Good morning. I'm Ted O'Brien, also a state senator from the Rochester and Finger Lakes region. I serve on the Special Committee on Science, Technology, Incubation, and Entrepreneurship, chaired by Senator Golden. I very much appreciated it and concur with Senator Golden's remarks that he made as he started out the day. Nowhere was his competency and brilliance more demonstrated than by the decision to have this work group discussion right here at RIT. So thank you for that, Senator Golden. Really look forward to hearing from every of you. I'm really here to listen and to learn so that I can somehow try to stay ahead of my 9 and 10-year-old daughters. Thank you.
I'll be short here. I'm Bob Herz. I'm director of the Senate Special Committee on Science, Technology, Incubation, and Entrepreneurship. I always have to slow down when I say the name of it because I'm going to forget a word if I go too fast.
And I want to thank you all. This is a tremendous, tremendous panel. We're going to get right into it. There are a series of questions that are on the back panel. There are some of the questions that we'll be going to. I don't think we'll be in any order, but I do believe we need to get the dialogue started. And we'd like to do it like we do in our conferences. When you feel like you got to jump in, you jump in, you put get recognized, and just get it out. And I'd like to start with Vicarious Visions. Where would you be if you weren't here in the state of New York?
You know, it's always hard to say exactly where we'd be. I think when my brother and I, we graduated college, we had to make a choice. At the time, we'd actually made our first game and published it. It was before independent development was cool or had any money going to it. Now it's a very different picture. We'd published our first game. We had a European customer that stopped returning our phone calls at that time. And so we got cheated out of our first deal. So we knew how to think about games as sort of a creative enterprise, but not as a commercial enterprise. And we met an angel investor that worked with the RPI Business Incubator that had started several successful software companies before. And he said, hey, look, you guys, if you keep your business here, I'll help you think about it, not just as a creative enterprise, but also as a commercial enterprise. You know, at that time, we had a lot of credit card debt, you know, to pay the people that we were working with and that kind of thing. We said, well, this is probably a pretty good idea. And, you know, there was no local industry there. There was no game development program. The first programmers we hired, we couldn't get anybody in the United States to move to Albany to make games. So the first programmers we hired came from Russia and China, and I traveled there myself to recruit them and did the visa paperwork myself. This was late 90s. We didn't have a .com at the end of our name, and so nobody was willing to invest either. You know, they would have kept their money with us and lost it elsewhere. So, you know, that was the story of our real beginnings in the capital region. And since then, it's been a consistent sort of, I mean, we've been fortunate to work with, you know, colleagues that have had high aspirations like we have had. And not to take no for an answer in terms of growing a very, very successful business, both creatively as well as commercially here. You know, I'd say if I would be someplace else, you know, right out of college, I had a job at McKinsey and Company. To go and consult with them. My brother had several jobs in Seattle as well as California. But it wasn't in our blood. What we said is we need to build a business and we need to work with like-minded people. And so we stayed here.
One quick follow-up question. What can New York do to implement and encourage the game companies to stay here? And is there anything we can do? And are you even thinking about looking at other locations?
You know, we're actually consistently asked, look, is this the best place to attract talent? In New York. And I think there are two components to that. One is, you know, I'll get to the tax part of it in a second, but there are two components to that. One is having kind of an entrepreneurial culture that doesn't take second place as an acceptable answer. Because we have to build a business that's best in the world here. And have enough people willing to be able to go after that with a level of passion and commitment that they won't fail. And I think that that's possible here. That's what we've tried to do here. And when I compare the talent base that we have at Vicarious to any other place in the world is, you know, I look at the last 10 years and what we've been able to do. There are very few companies that even had the longevity that we have had and the success record that we have had, you know, in the area as well. So, you know, the first item is getting the successful entrepreneurs to re-engage in the communities to encourage that culture of entrepreneurship. The second one is creating an environment that encourages culture and the arts of all kinds
and not just within our industry, but make it a fantastic place for creative people and young people to live. That creates a kind of talent magnet that's hard to fight anywhere in the world. These are the things that I continue to come back to. Now, I believe that capital really follows the talent and can follow the successful businesses as well. On the matter of tax credits, I like tax credits from the perspective that they're only useful if you're generating profits. So having economic growth is one of the key precursors to being able to benefit from tax credits. The other element is that we consistently are pressured on our costs. In New York, any place in the United States is not a place where you can operate business as a cost leader, especially in a labor-intensive business like software. So we're consistently out-competed on costs by places like Canada, Quebec, where they have very aggressive policies. So being able to nudge profitable, successful, economically vibrant businesses to continue to reinvest and grow here of all sorts, not just video games, I think would be a tremendous benefit.
Anybody else want to contribute on that? Bob, let me go to RJ. RJ, what do you think? What's your approach on gaming with Google, and what do we have to do as a state to encourage Google to do more work here and keep more of its work here in the state of New York, even though they are very good in the state of New York?
You know, I would actually add a little bit to that, to the previous answer. One of the things that started the industry in the early days, one of the things that drove California to become one of those magnets, was the fact that it was more than just software development, but there was also a key hardware development component in California. There was, in particular, the ability to fabricate hardware, to fabricate the chips. And it was the combination of that there was good schools in the California area for both hardware and software, and the fact that it was an industry that was developing and that all of the pieces were locally available. It helped it to start to develop that magnet quality. And California, as we know, has grown quite dramatically over the years in the size of the industry. And that was caused to great extent by this attractive quality, where going to the Silicon Valley was a place to go if you wanted to be in the industry, because there was a wealth of jobs and you could go anywhere you want and do anything you wanted. California also has wonderful weather that I don't know how we'll get around that in other places around the country. I'm a Chicago boy and I love the weather here, and so it would be a selling point for me. But the thing that RIT now has the advantage of is that you are creating this wealth of people that aren't just specific to one particular job, but you're creating that kind of community that you need, the cross-the-board group that has all of the talents that you need to get into the entertainment space. And there's so much that's needed, from the 3D graphic artists to the operating system level people. And, you know, while we're at it, you need hardware development as well. Because I still think that going forward into the future, having a foot in the door of hardware is always going to be an important thing to attract talent to a central location. I got a quick tour of the campus yesterday and found out that you have hardware development that you can do right here on campus. This is awesome. This is an amazing thing. I was so delighted to hear that this is underway here, because it gives you that momentum, it gives you that ability. And when I talk about hardware, I don't mean going off and inventing game consoles, which I have done myself over the years. But I mean like peripheral devices or new ways of thinking about interacting with computers. You need that invention, that kind of creativity to create the communities and to get that kind of momentum going to have people stay. Now, in terms of games and Google and how all that would work, Google's got a big presence in New York State, and that would not be a hard thing to accomplish at all. But I'm interested in talking with RIT in a bunch of different levels as well. Intern programs, a possibility of As my group grows within Google, we're going to want to reach out and get software development going on in many places around the world, and I would love to include RIT as part of that. And because I think that this place has that kind of possibility, that rich potential to not just create the talent, but to attract them to stay here and to start to develop and grow here. I don't know RIT that well yet. I don't know Rochester that well yet. But I've been talking with the school here about opportunities to work on software together and to develop things together. And I think that there is huge potential. We just have to find a way to get people to stay locally, and having that kind of group community, I think, is going to be key to it.
I wanted to jump back in with respect to the impact of tax credits.
Speak a little louder into that microphone. Yeah. Thank you.
So I'm Toby Salnier. I'm CEO of First Playable Productions. We're a 50-person game development studio. I am constantly approached by other states and countries to move my studio there with very attractive offers of tax credits. So all of the surrounding states, it's not just the West Coast, but all the states surrounding New York State plus Montreal have very aggressive tax credits. Would it impact me in terms of as much as 40% of my wages tax credits? In the end, that affects both the number of jobs I can provide and also the salaries that I can provide to those individuals. The reason I've stayed has been to be counter to the businesses do what's best for the business. I stay because I'm stubborn. I'm a native New Yorker, and I am determined to help create a change in New York State so we're not just seeing all our jobs move to our borders, move north, move south, move over to the West Coast. I think that's just a huge disadvantage, and it impacts me every day in my business, and it impacts everybody who works at my studio to not have the same support. Furthermore, every conference I go to has several geographic locations, states, and countries as well, actively supporting their small businesses who the small startups can't necessarily afford the visibility, can't afford a booth. So when I go there, again, not only being approached by the people trying to move jobs to their areas, if you're an individual going there, if you were to be working for Massachusetts, for Georgia, Maryland, Canada, every other country out there, you would have a place to show your game there without having to take on the cost of marketing to get your studio known and supported out there in the industry. New York State doesn't have it, and to the degree that I'm actually trying to create a New York State pavilion without New York State support, just because I want to help other small companies get up and started. So I think there are a number of things where New York State could make a huge difference in the startup culture and encouraging people to stay where they feel supported.
Thank you very much. Senator Robach, I think, may have had a question for RJ.
Well, you know, I was just going to say this is always interesting because, you know, I'm looking at the statistics of, in all honesty, who's ahead of us. And certainly while California has weather, as challenging as New York can be, Massachusetts and California are very high cost of business center, energy issues, and other things. So it's kind of interesting to see what drives it. But I guess what my question is, it sounds like, very much like other industries, now that this is something that they know is growing 10% exponentially, can be big, you're under constant recruitment. Do they do that at your infancy stages, or do they do that when the product is already out there and successful, try and get the company?
From day one, although I started the company with a very fast growth curve, so I was up to 30 people in a year. But I do believe that even small startups, because it's known as a startup-oriented industry, there is an active recruitment by people. That's why they're one reason they have the booths at the industries. And although I do make the cost of living argument in order to try to attract people and get them to ignore their very high salary offers from Seattle or, for instance, or California. I think that in the end, that cost of living is typically money back into the community. So in the end, a higher cost of living isn't bad if you can offer a higher salary, because that cost of living is actually largely your local economy that's contributing towards that. So I'm not against that, but I certainly do try to present that as an argument to defend the lower wage base that I can actually support within a global competition.
Senator, I do want to comment on the point that you made in terms of California and Massachusetts. You know, there are high cost factors for doing business there. But I think they've been able to create an ecosystem where they're able to actively
support many, many businesses trying to start up. And so the innovation breakthroughs tend to consistently come out of those places. And when the breakthroughs do come, they're a powerful enough economic engine to support the cost structure. That's something that's less common here. We have more of a big company culture here and less of a startup culture here. In fact, in California, if you go there, or if you go to Kendall Square right there, not Boston or the bigger area, but just at the nexus of MIT and the biotech cluster and the energy cluster there, there's one building with 400 startups in just a single building. That's across from the Sloan School of Management. And there, it's hard for the big companies to recruit because it's so much more exciting to be involved in a startup, have the upside potential of a startup, but the excitement and the creative potential of a startup, importantly. And the same thing is true in California as well. In the Silicon Valley, it's very difficult. Like I can talk about from Activision Publishing. Activision's our parent company at Vicarious now. It's very difficult for Southern California to recruit anybody from Northern California, even junior talent, because there's such a strong magnetism towards the possibility for innovation and new startup participation and that kind of thing. We just don't have the critical mass of that here. And so high-cost areas can balance out by encouraging a culture of innovation, by celebrating that innovation, by doing that enough and providing enough of a magnet and a kind of a community where that type of talent wants to live, that you're going to generate lots of these ideas, and some of them are going to succeed in a big way. And that really is a self-sustaining kind of dynamo.
You know, that's helpful. I think that's the kind of things we want to get to. Could I just ask one follow-up question, because I'm trying to get this too? So when you're starting up, at least in other industries, people always say that people in New York, unlike other areas which have this entrepreneurial spirit, don't want to invest private money till they're already down the road and successful, let's say in pharmacy or other technologies. Is that true also in the gaming industry, would you say? What creates the, I mean, RIT, we have a lot of good stuff. What creates that culture besides the academic setting, the people with the degrees? Is it really the cost of space? Is it the cost of accessing capital? What would complete that scenario you talked about, a culture of entrepreneur for small business growth?
I can speak from my personal experience, but I think we have some excellent other experience.
Well,
here
only
too.
To support mm-hmm. very much what you're saying, Guhan, mm-hmm. that some of you in the room may remember a company called Augmented Reality that got its start here, as a matter of fact. And they were in the process of seeking funding, and in fact, Excel was very interested in coming in. And they left to go out to a boot camp in Denver, Colorado with Techstars, again, a name that most of you will recall, Brad Feld, and never returned. And when we asked them why, it was very much to your point. When they got out to Denver, the infrastructure that was there, the support services, not just the financial, but the critical support services as far as the domain expertise, the talent, and the energy that they were surrounded with in that one area, they said, there's just nothing like it. We can go from 0 to 60 out here. It would take us 3 years or longer to try to do the same thing back here in Rochester. So you're absolutely right for everything you said on that point.
Now, one of the elements from my own personal experience, it's quite a common experience, I think, is that you know, being in a position of starting a business and going out there just trying to figure out how you're going to pay people and, you know, just the very, very early beginning, it's a very lonely place to be. There's no glamour in it. You sit on a broken task chair. I remember when we had our first accountants, we couldn't afford to pay them. You know, that's what it is. So you need to have a community to support you in that because you can easily have the attractive job elsewhere. And we could do more here as far as that goes. You know, the interesting thing about that is not about the fancy buildings or the fancy furniture. It's the density and the quality of the talent and the size of the aspirations. And those tend to be the most critical ingredients. Now, for us, some of the additional things were really committed, proven business people that were interested in helping, genuinely helping and structuring our thinking to be sort of better business people in addition to being creative. And I think that's a fantastic thing here that the Magic Center is starting. You don't get any of that in school. Even if you have a business degree, the practicality of actually making a payroll, or getting a sale. These are not taught in school. That's a feet on the street type of knowledge. As an investor, and I do angel investment as well, getting enough of those types of businesses that both have the creative talent but also the business structure and rigor to have a shot, we don't see enough of those to have that be a really interesting area of investment. So getting even the deal flow is a tough thing. But I think the raw materials, there's a lot of great raw material here.
Yeah, I'd like to actually...
Blake, before you speak, as you're about to speak, I was going to call on you anyway to give us a perspective of where you are today. And going back to Vicarious's comments on California, we have, Senator Robach knows, that Death Valley, that 90% of these businesses end up are very unsuccessful. If we, as a state of New York, were to invest in that area to try to help to get through Death Valley, to get you to production, to marketing, to get you the ability to have what Magic offers here, the ability for business to set up that business, to take that business to the next level. How does that help? And if we as a state could bring that 90% number down to, say, 60% and keep the majority of those companies here and let them get to production here in the state of New York, the benefits that would be here. If you could go over some of your trials and tribulations to where you are right now, we'd appreciate it. Go ahead, Blake.
Yeah, well, as Guha was saying, there's not a lot of community around us to help us figure out all the different trials and tribulations of starting a business. I mean, it's not necessarily easy, and there were a ton of questions we always had. And I mean, we were lucky to have faculty and friends that could help us a little bit, but we are in a little bit of a unique predicament. I mean, most of the support structure that we've had has actually been from Boston, and most of the business we've actually done has been in Boston. We've traveled there quite a bit to talk to different people. So if there could be more businesses, more startups, more of that culture around here, that would definitely help a lot, and we would definitely be doing a lot more active stuff around here. And as Toby said, there is no conference to really show off our work around here. We've traveled also to Boston to show off our work before, but we really don't have any way, especially as a startup with like no money, to get the free marketing aspect of that, to be able to show off our games at different events. So being able to I think, have some type of a conference to really try to stimulate the different game and the different innovation projects that are going on, and also the aspect of being able to try to attract more companies to stay here would definitely help a lot.
So we're not putting any more pressure on Andy and Magic here to try to set up some type of event in the future that would draw more people to Rochester and to RIT so that they could see and compete and take the opportunities that were afforded to you when you had your own competition, correct?
Yeah, definitely.
Well,
that's something?
We do some business with Colin, and we have in the past. I'd be happy to, I mean, we should... Come and see us.
Definitely.
Yeah. I'm happy to support.
Is it Ken? I'm sorry.
Yes. I'm going to suggest that there's a role for the community here in addition to the institutions, and it's a leadership role. In my first startup, we ended up having a positive experience, which is rare, but I learned something very much about the community that I live in. We had a little company. We worked away at it year after year after year. We developed a solid base of engineering talent, hardware and software. And where we were was in the seam between the telephone network and the evolving data network. And what we owned by the time we sold the company was a big chunk of intellectual property and products that today have a lot to do with the smartphones that you have in your hand. We put the company up for auction, essentially, between Cisco and Intel, and ended up selling to Intel and bringing Intel to Western New York. They were there for 8 years. The night we announced the deal, I received death threats because we didn't sell, we sold out. And I think what we need to do is teach the leadership in our communities that this is a numbers game, that we need to encourage not dozens of startups, but hundreds of them. And we are going to lose some of them. Some of them are going to go to San Jose, and some of them are going to go to Seattle. And that's just fine, because some of them are going to hit, and some of them are going to make deals and bring the residuals of those deals back to us. And it's growth over time. Intel stayed in Western New York for 8 years. Now, there's a corollary to this story. My second business, I flopped horribly, which was predictable. And I ended up being persona non grata among a network of investors in Western New York, and I learned something else. The real cultural issue that we have to attack is the behaviors that we reward. And I think we need to get to the root of rewarding young people who are willing to get it all out there and take a risk, as opposed to punishing failure, which is sometimes the behavior that we will see in more conservative and distressed communities. I think that's, and that is where, Senator, that's where you can help us, actually, because I think it is a, it's a statewide and community, it's a leadership issue.
Senator O'Brien?
Just as a follow-up to that, you know, obviously there's some great things happening here at RIT and the Center for Magic, and we do seem to be spurring some startup activity. And a lot of that can be assisted, obviously, with an appropriate tax incentive climate. And like one of the earlier speakers said, I think tax incentives can be very important. And I know Senator Golden and those of us in the legislature took a lot of criticism in the film industry as an illustration, because you look at the hundreds of millions of dollars in tax credit, but it's money that we otherwise don't have, and I think the tax incentive is an easier path to go. But my question is this: can we grow the industry here by focusing on startups, and, or do we really need to go beyond startup and new companies, and to get that critical infrastructure that you're talking about, do we need to recruit existing companies here if we're going to ever realistically get to the critical mass that we're talking about as Rochester and the Finger Lakes region really being a hotspot, or New York State in general?
If I might. So one thing, we're based out of Westchester, New York, and Westchester, New York not being a hotspot of startups. It's definitely, you know, cost of living is high enough, cost of office space is rather difficult to get around. So we're kind of at that funny cusp where we're definitely, all our employees, about 3 to 18, 3 to 20 a year, basically operate virtually. You know, we use virtual offices. We have slowly, over the last 3 years, ended up getting a core group around New York City and around that metropolitan area. But none of us as a group have been willing to kind of take the leap and get a shared office space, do that, you know, kind of break the nut and actually go take that leap. But Westchester in particular, I mean, it's a pretty affluent part of New York State. You'd think there'd be access to extra money and do this sort of thing. I can only think of two very small studios, about our size studio, you know, 1 to 2 full-time employees and then a cadre of freelancers and work for hire. And there's just not really a support mechanism for when you want to take the leap and get an office space, really have a mailbox ready to go. It's a funny thing, but when you take that leap from your own space to having a shared space for you and your employees, that's kind of a big deal. And then just outside of tax incentives, one thing that we've been kind of struck with recently, New York City's education department did a challenge post project. It was the math gap challenge. We submitted a project to it. Looking back on it, it's something that we'd love to see more of. Sometimes it's hard for us to take a, pushes us towards building a product we might not have built, because we'd have to take it all on faith that we're going to build it, get it out there, and then recruit the schools after the fact. I think, especially when you have an educational center like the New York City school system, that's an excellent place to start. If they could do that more frequently, tell us what they need, maybe set up yearly projects or yearly contests so that local game companies could enter in projects and do that, that would be excellent. And they're really, those projects do tend to go more towards the smaller developers as opposed to the more established developers, because you're only looking at prize money of, you know, let's say $50,000 or something like that. That may not be what a AAA studio is going to look at. But for us, that means that we can meet all the costs of having built the product if we're received well right up front. And then we still own a certain portion of it. The New York, you know, the school district takes it on, and being one of the more visible school districts, other educators find out about it. So just from a perspective, larger institutions like that can definitely play a big role without breaking the bank and going into tax, you know, into tax questions or where the money's coming from the state level.
I'd like to, if we can, stay right where you are, but I want to go back to Bob for a second. The I look at RIT, and those that have been around, you look at the incubators. Incubators are, you know, a couple hundred people, could be 20, 30 people. Here I see 795 people in a incubator, and I see them working side by side in teams. That gives them the ability to go to that next level when we heard from Blake and where he was able to create his idea or the team's idea and to move that forward. What is the incubator entrepreneurial culture? What do we have to do to create that, to move in a direction and try to take a look at all the aspects? A, incubator, to getting through Death Valley, to the large guys, the big players, and setting up the tax-free zones that we need to be able to do to keep the big guys here, but what do we do for the little guys, and how do we put it all together?
I think it's an excellent question, and I think the very first thing that has to happen is that leadership in the community, the college, the sponsoring institutions associated with an incubator all have to say that that's the reason that we're building the incubator. As a matter of fact, I'm the heretic on campus. I'm the private guy. I've never been in an academic community. I have no economic development background at all. I'm a serial entrepreneur, and they brought me onto campus, and they got what they deserved. I maintain that the reason that you do an incubator, especially in a smaller region, is to build and reinforce the entrepreneurial culture in the community, and the other reason that you do it is to develop private wealth in the community, which is what creates businesses and jobs. Now, that's not always the statement that I can deliver when I'm talking to my constituents. They want to hear something slightly different, but you get there eventually. First thing is, that is the mission. We're developing this, we're designing this, we're building this in order to either develop, expand, or support the entrepreneurial culture. The second thing is you do not limit the scope of the effort. We work on this very hard. We use the building for all sorts of things other than the tenants in the building. I think the worst possible thing you can do with an incubator is lock the doors during the middle of the day, look at the 20 tenants you have in the building, and say, this is the scope of our mission. We last year ran 100 events in our building, and we're looking at doing more. We're actually right now looking at how we can use the incubator as a mechanism to deliver curriculums and value out to small business all throughout the region, and then blend our entrepreneurs who are already on Main Street in with our young people. I think our young people who are founding businesses in our incubator actually need to rub shoulders a little bit more often with people who have 20 years of battle scars. And an incubator is an ideal platform. The third thing, we need to begin to figure out ways to network incubators. There's assets here that will take me 10 years to build if I try and do it myself. There's assets in Fredonia that are astonishing, and we're not sharing them, we're not introducing them, we're not networking them. I walk 22% of the graduating class at Fredonia in visual and performing arts. Game developers need sculptors in 2D and 3D. They need actors. They need voice. That's what we do. And as with a tiny little bit of travel between the two of us, it was a two-hour drive today. I've done longer commutes in San Jose to in the old days. and with the internet, you know, I think that we need to be taking a look at how our young people who are looking to lead these industries are reaching out and taking advantage of things that are happening in these other institutions.
May I add one point here? So, Bob, building on the geographic angle, you know, I think we do have a lot of jobs in New York State, but outside of the city, they're, you know, geographically really disparate. The institutions are disparate, the incubators are, the investment community is pretty disparate as well. It's pretty diffuse. And so, you know, where there's a concentration benefit in Boston or in Silicon Valley, we don't get the same kind of benefit here. You know, I'm still astounded in our community in the Capital Region. The incubator at Sage doesn't talk that much to the one at University at Albany or the one at RPI. There is a community of investors, the Eastern New York Angels, there's a community around Syracuse, and they've started a much more active communication to unify. But we have this kind of historic, you know, kind of separation from geography, and it really prevents us from taking all of these different companies and ideas and making them one community that really has the awareness of how they can learn from each other, how they can cross-invest or do business with each other. Even that single community would be a powerful asset to a business relocating in this state and saying, what are all the supporting industries that will help me do business here? Because in this type of industry, we're not locating a plant or a factory that's self-contained and within its borders, you know, includes all the services. To relocate, you know, 100 game jobs from Texas, from Austin, where I think we can compete with Austin in communities like Rochester or Albany or Saratoga Springs. To be able to do that, we need to be able to have a community that then offers employment for the trailing spouses, that offers the related supporting industries and that kind of thing that can feed both the talent as well as services, you know, into that. And right now, it's just all sort of separate. And so I think that one of the big responsibilities that the state can undertake, and something to really move the needle, is an integration role there. It's something that no one institution can actually do. But of course, the state, with some kind of private sector partnership and university partnership, can really make a big difference.
Well, it's amazing that he brought that up, and I'll go back to you in a minute, Rob. It was interesting to have the same discussion in Downstate and NYU Poly. And everybody on the dais, and we had a very talented dais down there, as we do here today, nobody knew each other, which I found that amazing, how you had the developers of Grand Theft Auto not knowing anybody on this panel and vice versa. Does everybody in this panel, is this anybody here put your hand up if you would want to, that is the first time that you've met the individuals on this panel? First time you've met, first time, and you're doing Google Play, you're doing all these different, we have different talent here that should have already met, I believe. So getting back to your comment, I believe it would be appropriate in setting up that venue, that vehicle for that venue to happen.
I think Google needs to visit more people.
I'm up for that.
Bob?
If I could throw in something else, too. I love Guha's answer about culture, but there was one thing he said that made me stop, and that's that he was making a joke about startups not really being glamorous. I think the opposite is true, especially when you think about young people. That thought about staying up all night, all weekend, never getting any sleep, living off of coffee and candy bars, and being part of that new, exciting, big thing that's coming together, that is a big part of the draw of the industry, especially for younger people. They love that thought, but they may not know just how important, just how valuable it is, and they also may not know where it's all going. And so an idea occurred to me when these gentlemen were talking, maybe an interesting idea would be with these incubators, which I think are really incredibly important, maybe you could seed some of those incubators with some of these people that have been in the game industry for a while, and you know, not have them be part of the startups, but have them be part of the group that helps the startups go, gives them that vision, encourages them to work that way, and you know, and beefs up the overall effort, the overall productivity of what the incubators would do, hopefully make them more successful. And then finally, if the incubators are really powerful and really do have that smack of game industry to them, that then it would draw even more people to the school.
Bob, if you could come back on that, and then Senator Robach.
I would suggest that one of the issues, if I look backwards, one of the issues that might have caused me as an incubator director to be a little protective of my clients is the sustainability algorithm for an incubator, which expects me to retain that client for a certain period of time and see certain revenue streams come off that client. I think the right thing to do is sometime in the near future, there probably should be a reciprocity agreement between Fredonia and RIT. If it doesn't work, let's rip it up and move on. But let's let the performing arts talent at Fredonia and the game development talent at RIT interact with one another and see what happens. With the advent of innovation hotspots, designated incubator, and Startup New York, I am far less worried about my clients talking to clients and other incubators. You can come and completely solve this problem for all of us.
I'm the guy you want on the incubator panel, that's for sure.
Senator Robach?
I was just going to say I want to make sure I understand it correctly, because I think, you know, hopefully at the end we'll have a list, and certainly the, you know, the tax credit issue, I'm going to take a look at what that is and what we have to do in addition to what we already have to stay competitive. You know, you've given us some other ideas, but I want to make sure I understand this part. So we already do have, like, you know, some things, high tech Rochester, other things that aren't specific to an industry to help people start up. But I think what I'm hearing is that you think to create the culture to really make a big impact or make it look like a natural place to stay, you have to create something specific for this field, have it be known not only through the academic community here at RIT, but also on the commercial side and all across the industry, I think is what, is that fair to say that everybody agrees with that?
I suffer a little bit of the same problem, and by the way, I'm gonna speak for Fredonia globally now, just as opposed to my program. We do a great job in the performing arts, and then they all leave town.
Right.
You can go all across the country and find Fredonia grads working in the performing arts. As a matter of fact, the proof was really driven home to us. We just recruited in an independent film studio that left LA and came back home. She's an expatriate. She kept a piece of her business in LA and had no trouble recruiting Fredonia alum in LA. I don't consider that a particular problem. What would be thrilling for us as a region is if we can start to build some network, highly networked, highly leveraged relationships that cause us to be a magnet for some percentage of those people to stay, and we begin to develop more of a creative economy. There's a lot of support for that, because if you take a look at what's happening in at the western end of the state, we're becoming a wine region. You add the arts to wine and tourism, it's a nice mix for us. But it is frustrating to watch so much talent walk across the stage in May and then walk right out of town. If we could put the relationships in place where we were working with you, or we were working with you guys, and we were using a portion of our facilities in the building as a studio for our creative building people to create some content that were going into your products, let's do it. They'd stay, by the way. They absolutely would stay, I guarantee it.
Andy?
I wanted to actually call on Colin a little bit. Colin and I had a conversation a couple of years ago that he may not remember, but it stuck with me to this very day. I was asking him in some kind of an off-the-record session, you know, what were some of the hardest things in starting up Darkwind? What were some of the hardest things in making it? And just to give a little history, you know, Colin has been very successful in our incubator. He has faced a buyout situation recently.
they've thought about at times relocating. But one of the things that he said really struck with me, so I'm going to put his own words in his mouth that he doesn't remember, and then he has to comment on them, so this should be fun. He said, one of the most difficult things about having Darkwind here is that nobody else does what they do. And that really resonated with me, and that stuck with me in a lot of the formulation around what we're trying to do with Magic. So I wonder if you could tell a little bit of that history, that feeling.
Well, I suppose that, and I'm sure this was very off the record, this conversation.
Colin, at the advice of counsel, don't say another word.
Well, I think that what ended up happening was that, so we've had a lot of support from the incubator, and it's been fundamental to our success so far. We wouldn't be successful without it. We wouldn't be alive as a company without it. But I do believe that we were offered a lot of business advice while we were starting that didn't support our company's goal. There was a lot of advice to find an investor, find a 3-year plan, sell your company. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. You know, make a product, do your best, and, you know. And we were having meetings with different people that didn't quite understand what we wanted to do, and they would share their experiences with us, but what we wanted to do was we wanted to make a sustainable game studio. We didn't have a 3-year plan to make, some single app that either succeeds or doesn't, and then we all make a lot of money and run away. We wanted to make a company that when we're 40 years old, we're still working at, we're still providing jobs, we're paying payroll, we're making games. That was our company goal. And I think I felt a little bit alone because while everybody was, you know, we'd have meetings set up with investor A or investor B, but as was mentioned earlier, no one really taught us how to do payroll and like how to manage a day-to-day business and how to charge clients and how do you just grow your company, like how do you add employees and how do you support them and when do you provide health insurance and when do you give raises and what's the right amount of money to pay people. And I guess I felt like, and what's also interesting to me is like I felt like we had to learn that over time, and it took us a long time to learn. It's been 6 years now. And we finally figured it out, and if we had better advice of someone doing it before us, we might have moved quicker. And now this is the first time I'm hearing about Blake, who sounds like he's in the exact position we were 4 years ago. So again, I'm not sure what the solution is, but starting a game studio felt very lonely when we started at first. And perhaps it is just bringing companies together, connecting them. I know that we are irresponsible in our community, and that Matt and I, we've talked about this before, we could be much more active in talking to students that want to start up their organizations. But somehow, like, there just needs to be that, whether metaphorically or physically, we need to have that building that Boston has where 400 startups are all working together, trying to make games or trying to make interactive media. I just think that would really support, that would take that 90% of unsuccessful startups number down considerably.
Staying where you are right there with Andy, again, magic now is created. Magic is that opportunity for the Blakes of the world that came in after you, Colin. At least I think that was what magic's or part of Magic's mission is, to get that group up, running, going, if they can, to take them to production or get them to the angel or to the VC so that they can move to that next level. And if that's part of the mission of Magic to do that, are we missing that in the outer world, that 400 startups in a company? What is the magic for them? What is the magic for Rochester? What would we do to set up an anchor tenant where we could set that anchor tenant and have those 300 to 400 startups here in Rochester? Andy?
Yeah, I mean, I think if in the long term, I mean, magic is new, right? That's no surprise to anybody in the room. I think if it's to be successful in the long term, the vision of where I see it is it sits on the edge of campus, right? It sits on the edge of campus in the sense that it has to take what's happening inside the campus and promote it and extend it outward and act as a bridge to a community, right? It has to act as a bridge to a community that it is that responsible partner in, right? RIT should be connecting you and Blake and all of these other folks in this region, and RIT should be, through magic, engaged in creating the networks of everybody at this table. And so should the reciprocal organizations of other universities beginning to bridge those networks across the state. So, you know, magic, in a sense, is about meeting students at their passion, right? The students that I talk to want to build things. They are building things. And they really want to figure out. They don't know that they want a business yet, necessarily, right? I remember Colin before... Colin was sure that a business was a good idea, right? which is strange to even think about now, right? Because it's in his blood, and I think it was probably going to happen no matter what. But for other students, you know, they don't know necessarily that that's in their future, but they're passionate about building things, and it's our job, I think, to make that a realized opportunity, to make that a realistic and understood path in ways that I don't think that higher education in general has necessarily promoted in that way before.
Ken, I'm going to come back to you in a second, but staying where you are right now, Andy, the Blakes of the future, those groups that will formulate.
I think we still have a shot at keeping him, by the way.
Pardon me? I'm going back to you in a second, too. And as a matter of fact, you should be part of this conversation. You know, you're looking at college loans. You're looking at max credit cards. You're looking at areas that you're saying, wow. They can't even fathom beginning that business. So to get to that next level, I guess magic plays that role, as you did with Colin, I believe. It sounds like you played a role here in giving Colin the opportunity to see through that maze and go for the business and set it up. What do we have to do to continue that process? You bridge to the next level. What is that next level here in Rochester?
Well, I think part of it is that universities are guilty at starting lots of things and finishing almost nothing, right? It's in our blood because we often get to proof a concept and we say, you know, hooray, good job, all done, write your paper, and then we're set. And that, you know, so part of it is just actually finishing things, right? Part of it is you're not paying out on student loans when you're a junior, right? And people build lots of stuff when they're juniors. And if they had stuff built and realized, right, in ways that were able to take on investment by the time they were done or just after they were done, that's a very different scenario, right, than saying, I think I want to start something and looking 2-3 years in the future down a student loan. You know, those are not equitable, right? Now, I may come back to our state and local governments and say maybe there are ways that we can address some of the student loan thing that's happening as well through other mechanisms. But I think part of it is being up and ready, not after you graduate, but through the process of graduating is a very different thing. One of the neat things about, you know, what Colin and those guys were doing, they didn't make a business after they graduated, as I recall. You had that business, at least you had the team, and were working on stuff well before you were out the door.
Yep.
Right? And that, to me, is critical for models to work. Right? It's easy to make teams when everybody's localized on a campus and making good things happen. It's much harder to keep teams together when everybody's graduating, right? And one of your team members goes off to Microsoft, as you said before, right? So, you know, that's the hook, right? The hook is to actually look at what we can build and have things actually being finished and getting out the door, right, before we're stepping off campus, because that's a much more interesting platform to grow from.
If I may, Mike, with teams like Blake's, getting the first product, whether it be a success or not, just getting a product out there and being able to point to it and say we did something, even if it's a failure, even if it's, you know, your company and you basically kneecapped yourself on your first failure, it at least gives you a starting point from which to dig out. I mean, very similar to Guhav, our first product, definitely like our first attempt at a project, was nothing but like losses against the board. And then you had to dig out after that, and it's very tough, speaking to what Colin said as well. It's a very lonely place. When the money's all going out, it's all your money, and you're now probably looking down the barrel of not having paid yourself for 2 months because now you have to pay your vendors and the bank at the same time. Having somebody to talk to that has a clue what's going on is a great resource, and one that I think probably the majority of us didn't have, at least for the first year or so. I mean, like, if I'd known Guhav at the time I'd started my company, I would have probably been making calls on, like, a monthly basis just to find out, like, how do I do this? Does this make sense? Should I eat the loss here and just move on to something else? So if you're going to any discussion about incubators and how to properly build them should also probably include support from the established companies, not necessarily money, but access to people that started the company, you know, ongoing business VPs, people who can give at least some advice, let's say once a quarter, like just meet up with the incubator and just give like a quick lecture on how you do this and say, if you need to reach me, here's how you reach me. Because I don't think, you know, if somebody's well established already and did a business, they're gonna be interested in seeing what is coming out of other people, if only just to give them an idea of what's coming in the competition in the future, but mostly because it's somebody to talk to who's undergoing the problems that you face, and it's fun to offload some of the information and try and help these guys out, because we're a couple years behind where Colin is and a couple years in front of where Blake is. So it's, we would have appreciated the help, but I can definitely see how if there's going to be people coming out of Magic, there needs to be some sort of group, if it's not alumni, maybe local businesses, New York businesses, things like that, to help these guys come out of it.
And I think that's fortunate because I was in an incubator, the RPI incubator, before it became a virtual incubator. I was in a building with other companies that were software companies. One of them I convinced to jump more into the game industry. We traded client contacts. We, you know, constantly comparing notes. That incubator was fortunate to have a visionary who had led it previously, and there were handy books on the wall about, like, how do you do payroll? I remember going up to the office and just saying, I need a payroll company, and they started giving me a bunch of names. I'm like, no, I just need, like, one name. I'm going to optimize this in 2 years. Right now, I just need payroll, and they connected me with a legal guy who was volunteering, and so I was fortunate that I just happened to be starting the company at a time that there were resources that had just been created and hadn't gotten out of date, and the local economic development group had a CEO Connects program that was a training program that connected me to other experienced people. So I think that benefited the whole set of us that were fortunate enough to start at that point. I don't think that exists anymore. The building is closed. It's a virtual system, which has a disadvantage that you don't have serendipity. You actually have to talk about specific thing every time you get together, and you don't have that kind of cafe, coffee house sort of water cooler, printer, why does the fax not work sort of situation.
We may go back to that and shortly, and that's finding an anchor tenant and trying to get businesses to locate or co-locate around or with that anchor tenant. But I think it's a good lead into the money people here, and I'd like to, Teresa and Dennis, if they could contribute something and the money aspect of this. How do we get to a point, and then what happens?
Let me take a crack at that. The venture capital industry is an industry that many people do not understand, and it lives by certain rules and certain practices. Typical venture capital firms are organized as 10-year limited partnerships. In that 10-year period, they have to invest in companies, they have to grow those businesses, they have to exit those investments and return capital. So they are generally interested only in companies that they see have very, very substantial and immediate growth potential, because that will fit their financial model. So companies that aren't quite ready are not going to be picked up by the VCs. Doesn't mean that they aren't great companies, they just don't fit the model. The other is that VCs typically invest very close to home. The Boston VCs that have incubators with 400 companies in them, they can go in and cherry pick and identify the candidates. We don't see often Boston VCs in Rochester. We don't often see New York City VCs in Rochester, because they have their own ecosystem and that they feed that and benefit from it. We occasionally do see some. More often is the case where we have companies that are based locally that have made the cut in the VC system, and they're off to Boston or New York City, which is good for the state, to chase the money that's available there. So one of the things that we should be doing in this region is to develop a larger pool of local venture capital or upstate venture capital, so that we are then here to serve the companies that are in the upstate region. And an hour drive for a VC is no big deal, but a two-hour flight with a transfer is a big deal. They just don't do it. The other side of it is readiness. I've heard a lot of comments about very, very basic business stuff that in the VC world, we know how to do it. The companies that we invest in know how to do it. The process of getting ready is a process that ought to be handled through the academic institutions and the incubators and the accelerators, because this is basic stuff that these young companies should have. And the money that they need to do that should not be risk/investment capital. It ought to be capital that is helping these young businesses get to the point of readiness for VC. And some of the companies that are not yet ready for VC but have moved through Epic and related incubators and so forth, you look back 10 years and you will see that some of those companies that did not pass the cut for venture capital ended up being wonderful companies in a community. They are substantial, they create jobs. It's just that the timing and the staging of the company was not right for venture capital at the time that they were looking. So another wrinkle is, if we could not only develop venture capital in the upstate region, but modify the model a little bit so that it wasn't a 10-year limited partnership, it had a longer life. You can be much more patient about the type of investment that you would make, and this would be of immense benefit to the upstate region. I'm sure Teresa can add to this in a
productive way.
Before
Teresa goes, I'd like to have one more comment from you, if you can. If you a thought on how we could create that pool of VCs.
I would say this. Trillium had the benefit of an allocation from the Common Retirement Fund in our last fund, which is about a $50 million fund. I know that the limited partner investors today are moving away from the early stage space, because in the last 10 years, there was a period of the internet boom. You couldn't lose money. You'd throw money at companies and they got sold fairly quickly and everybody made a bundle. After the internet rollover, the telecom rollover, the profitability in the early stage space has not been great. So that the institutional investors tend to go in cycles, and they're now moving to the later stage space. So building a pool of early stage capital that would focus on upstate New York, somewhat agnostic as to space, but focusing partly on gaming, would be wonderful. And to have it built in a way that would have it not go out of existence in the end of 10 years, but could recycle the capital to provide more of a permanent source of capital for the upstate region, would be terrific. It's much too long a conversation to have at this workshop, but it's an area that I think does deserve discussion.
We'd like to have and continue that conversation in the future, if that's okay with you.
Happy to do it.
If you can send us some thoughts so that we can do some homework before we have that meeting, we would look greatly appreciate
it. Delighted to do it.
Teresa?
I would just support what Denny has said and offer the information that 6 years ago, there was virtually no seed money available in all of upstate New York. And over the last couple of years, as you are aware, the legislature passed and created and established for the first time in New York State the Innovate New York Fund, which has $35 million brought about by the state of New York and another $10 million that came in as a partnership with Goldman Sachs, putting $45 million in play for seed stage investing in New York State. Excel, I'm happy to say, is one of the managers of part of that money, and it's really helped a lot in terms of getting money flowing at the pre-revenue stage, which is what most of the individuals are coming out of the universities. So we have seen some progress there, and that money is being deployed, and they're tracking it on a regular basis. And there are basically seven venture capital funds across the state of New York who are managers of this $45 million, and it's being deployed as we speak. As Denny accurately stated, though, in Excel's case, we actually have companies in our portfolio now who are reaching the revenue stage, introduction to market, and they are ready for that next round of investment, and there is no venture capital money for that next round available locally. And we do have a very hard time attracting venture capital from downstate for the reasons that Denny stated. In fact, when we have tried to get venture capitalists from downstate to look at upstate, we've basically been told, and this is good news for you, don't bother unless it's a kid with a laptop. Because a lot of the inventory in upstate New York is in the life science and material science, which has a longer gestation period, and it's just not the kind of thing that the venture capital industry is interested in when they have limited partners who are not getting younger by the day and who need to get a successful return. So the good news is that for those of you who are in the IT gaming space, that is the space for VCs in New York State where they are looking to invest. So there's an incredible opportunity there. And again, I tend to agree with Denny. This is a broader discussion, but we appreciate your opening up the topic.
My question to both, I would imagine not would we just want Denny, that we'd want you there as well. We'd want to be able to put a couple of people in that room, I presume, correct? And have to be able to go back and forth and see what the best avenues are. There are two guys here, Shane and Jason, that are in different levels and different companies. What were your biggest challenges? What's your biggest challenge?
Well, right now, we're trying to increase the value of our IP that we're granted. My company is a partnership between MGM, Lionsgate, and Paramount. So we have thousands and thousands of movies and content coming out constantly. We're on the traditional media side. We need to make our content more interesting if we're going to sell through to your cable channel operators. That means that if we're competing with Netflix and all these other digital environments, we have to take the same IP and add an interactive aspect to it. We need to make games. We need to make things that allow you to interact with things as they're happening. NBC has a fantastic example with their, I think it's Defiance, the MMORPG that is tied to their actual show that's running, and the information goes back and forth. Things you do in one show up in another place. We in media recognize this, and we recognize that we can't sit by and have people watch. They have to interact in some way, whether it's a second screen or putting the content inside of a gamification environment where they watch all these things at once. When we are building this content, we're building it on a game platform, and we know this. We don't have anyone we can trust in the state. We've had a very difficult time working with that. In addition, on top of that, the hardware that we're working with the PS4 and the Xbox One, if they're not in state, we can't actually see things as it's happening. We can't actually interact with it. And since these are very highly protected intellectual property things, that means that we have to fly to Vancouver, Nova Scotia, Montreal, Los Angeles. We do this all the time. It would save us probably 10 to 15% of the overall cost if we could trust people in state. We're doing this every day.
How do we do that?
Well, that's the question. One of the things that's different about media versus games is that we have competitors. When he was saying, how do I pay this guy, how much do I know? I know exactly how much I have to pay him because NBC is doing the same thing. So's the sci-fi, so's Discovery. We're all in the same spot. So therefore, we have a sense of what the correct levels are. And I can compete with it. It also, because it's such a fluid environment, One of the things that happens here that doesn't happen in New York, if I decide I'm going to go right here in Rochester and I'm going to build my company, what's my fallback plan? If I'm in New York City today, if my startup fails, I can get a job at MTV. I can get a job at NBC. I can do those things. My life is fluid. My financial situation is fluid, especially with young graduates coming out of college. They have no idea what's going to hit them tomorrow. Having the additional options to be able to go from a startup environment to maybe a longer-term career environment and back and forth, as you've done, and so have I, that's comforting. But if game people don't have the ability to go from a startup to, well, rock star or not, you know, there's fewer options. And again, there are people in the space who are doing this, but it hasn't reached that critical mass. The inertia hasn't quite reached yet. You can maybe jump from a startup to a startup, but when we're talking with a development company with 250 resources in Montreal, they don't worry about making payroll as much as they worry about the flow of business. And it lets them just focus on what they're doing. And each time I hear these guys are saying, well, I have to figure out how to do this, that, and the other thing in Rochester, in New York City, or in other areas of New York City, in New York state itself, there's a challenge, at least in my perspective, of how do you get that critical mass? How do you make it so that each one of these businesses can actually share talent? You know, let's be honest about it. When we're in media, it's a very incestuous group. My talent goes from my company to someone else's company to someone else's company, but they have that sense of expertise in that realm. If you're doing technology in a game system today, and you're in Rochester, where do you go? What's your next step? And that's, you know, one of the reasons why we spend, I think last year we spent, you know, not a huge amount, but I'd say $7 or $8 million doing development on game systems, and very little of it was in New York State.
That's not good.
No, that's why I'm here.
Jason?
Well, it sounds like I should talk with Shane.
Use the microphone, please.
For us, I mean, everything that we talked about today as far as keeping employees here in Rochester, that's a big challenge. It's one of my big concerns is we have these great incubators. We have RIT creating all these incredible gamers, but how do we keep them here? That's a big concern for me. The average age of my employees is 25, and I have about 30 employees. And my biggest concern is they're going to leave me to go to Seattle or to San Francisco. And I'm sure many other people here are concerned with that as well. So that's a big concern for me. In addition to that, taxes are a big one as well. But the biggest one now with my company is we're a service-based company, and we have money coming in to do more service-based, but to really grow the company, it's getting venture capital to focus on IP and creating our own content that we can then sell or pitch and have recurring revenue instead of just service-based revenue. So that's one of my big pushes is to focus on creating intellectual property that we own and not just being a service-based company. So hearing about local venture capital is interesting and seeing that seed money here to help out with that. We've been approached by Canadian venture capital companies and companies downstate, and, you know, it's an interesting track to pursue, but those are some of my biggest concerns.
We worked with Ted and with Joe, and we set up here with the governor, we set up these tax-free zones within our SUNY systems across the state of New York, and that would incentivize companies moving into those locations. That would obviously work at a certain segment of your industry, and goes to the thought process of setting up that anchor and having those individual businesses set up around them, but the small startups don't have a tax issue. So it doesn't really benefit them, but it does benefit a person that's in heading in your direction. And of course, we also added several million square feet that we can add across the state that are outside of the SUNY system that would give us the ability, places like RIT and others, to have that focus and to be able to set up that 400 company from Boston to set it up right here at the doorstep of RIT to be able to have those opportunities. Go ahead, Ken.
So what you're saying about setting up like the companies in there and when's the right time to do things like that, one, and I guess we'll just call it an opportunity miss, but there could have been a real opportunity to do something. I'm sure you guys remember when Reader's Digest left their office space, right? When they kind of went out of business, and the really lovely building that is the Reader's Digest kind of got, I think, privately purchased and now is a split up kind of office space for, and they're having trouble, I believe, actually filling it because it's Westchester in Mount Kisco, Chappaqua. It's kind of an awkward place. That would have been an almost prime place if you could set up something where it's a just out of town incubator. You know, you have NYU students, you have people who maybe went home after college to Westchester or live just in the city, could easily have commuted out if you set up an incubator in a place like that. So I think keeping an eye out for when companies turn over these large office spaces that are centrally located, other things like that, and potentially earmarking one or two and just in a regional area for office space that can be put towards people who are just bringing up, just getting out of incubators, just branching off from careers into startups. That would have been an excellent shot, and I'm sure there'll be more that'll come up in the future. And just that would have been a big deal, and that's something I would suggest to keep an eye out for.
Well, that is why we set up that extra couple of million square feet to be able to work in locations around the regions, around the state of New York to focus in on. Again, that would be a different segment of this industry that would benefit from that. We have the other part of, or several parts of this industry that would not. Microsoft, how many people do we have in the state of New York, and how do we get more of Microsoft instead of Blake going to, what state is that, Blake? Don't tell me. Don't tell me. Instead of having Blake go to a certain state, why don't we have more of Microsoft here, and what prevents Microsoft from wanting to put more people into the state of New York? What's the barriers? Not putting you on the spot here, by the way.
Yeah. It's going to be hard for me to talk about why isn't Microsoft here or the numbers of people that we have in Microsoft. In terms of Microsoft being here, most of our presence is in Redmond, in Washington. And it goes back to this co-location idea that we've been talking about the incubators. Microsoft really believes in co-location and having kind of this critical mass of talent, of employees, being kind of in the same time zone, close to one another. And in my particular space, in the university relationship space, when I see incubator spots, that's a great way of building talent, of having a number of companies, new startups, being co-located, being able to leverage resources and services that are too difficult for them to get on their own. We've talked about legal, like which group of four or five individuals would want to hire a lawyer, or human resource services, or rent. So the having a solid incubator, having a building where you can have a group of people working together is really beneficial. In terms of our presence in New York State, I wouldn't be able to talk to that, but what I can talk to is that we're always on the lookout for partners. We're on the lookout for people that are going to develop on our platforms, on Xbox One, for Windows 8, for Windows Phone. And if there are people in New York State to do that, like Vicarious Vision, then that's wonderful. Like, we just need more people, in our case, developing for our platforms. And that's how we win, by having the new ideas, the new developers coming out for new games for our platform is a big win for us.
Go ahead, Teresa.
Thank you. I must be channeling Senator Robach because I feel compelled to make a plug for upstate New York here, in one regard at least. And that is, this gentleman just mentioned rent and some of the other reasons that might factor in. And I have to tell a story about one of our companies in our portfolio who went to Boston to make a pitch. And when he appeared before the VC took his business plan and tossed it in the middle of the table and said, You destroyed your credibility with me. As soon as I read in your business plan that you projected $5 a square foot for rent, he said that was ludicrous. He said you destroyed your credibility. And the guy looked up at him and says, but that is what we pay for rent, and I can show you my lease. So there's a lot to be said for what you get in upstate by way of the quality of living, but also the cost being cheaper, both for legal. We have the talent, we have the resources, we have the universities, and we have an awful lot to offer for the Googles and the Microsofts who might be looking for real value for your dollar. That's my plug. Thank you.
Speaking to that, you know, one of the things that is become apparent is that there's two different groups who have two different sets of needs. There's the young guys starting in an incubator who have not as much need for tax help, and then there's larger companies that can really use those tax credits. And we're also hearing that the big guys can use talent from the little guys, and the little guys could then get advice from the big guys. Maybe it's not just an incubator in its traditional sense of just people in the startup. Maybe you seed an incubator with that anchor tenant, as you've been mentioning. Bring in a Microsoft, give them the tax incentives that they would then make sense to bring those people over and promise them access to a universe of very highly qualified resources inside of that incubator space. It's a peanut butter and chocolate kind of situation where we should be seizing these kind of moments and saying, okay, it's good for Microsoft, it's good for the startups, it's good for New York State.
Somebody else had their hand up.
I just want to throw thing in too. Creating the incubator and starting these students out with a great career here in Rochester or Albany or wherever, whatever smaller city in New York it is, when I chat with my employees, one of the big thing is the infrastructure of living here and staying here. And maybe that's a question for Colin and Blake. You know, Colin, why did you stay here? Why didn't you move? What things kept you here? And Blake, you know, culturally, what's missing in Rochester or Albany or Buffalo that will root those people here and make it so they stay and have a family and live here forever?
Jason, two great questions, but I know what Blake's answer is going to be. But Colin's, I think, is the interesting answer, I think, is what we want to hear right now. I know that Blake was offered probably a very nice paycheck and having some bills and having a future, still being able to play with his team and do what he wishes to do with his team in advancing his their goals. I think he believes he can still do that. But Colin, maybe you can.
You probably don't want to hear this, but I grew up in Boston.
No, I do want to hear that because you're here.
And, I came to RIT and we started, as Andy mentioned earlier, the company while we were in school back in 2007, right before I had graduated my undergraduate program. And the question came up too, like, how do you deal with student loans and not get a job and things like that? And the tactic that I took to pay myself or be paid while we struggled through our first 2 years or so of business was that I decided to get a master's degree. And so that was essentially my, the way I was able to convince my parents to let me stay here and try this startup. And regarding why we're in Rochester still, and to be honest, it's not a great, I love the city, but there was a point in time where we kind of thought, well, maybe we should move to somewhere more exciting. It had nothing to do with tax incentives. It had nothing to do with, this city not providing incubator, this or that. It was more about wanting to be somewhere a little more exciting. San Francisco, Boston, just something with a little more entertainment, I suppose. We ended up here because despite having many conversations about moving, we were so busy trying to start a business that we just never did it. And we never looked anywhere else. And now when we expanded to about 15 people, it got too difficult to move. And that's not a decision that I regret in any way. I love the city and we're doing great here. And there's so much that I can talk about with regards to what RIT offers us and how important it is to our business success. But when we were in that early stage, when we were about 2 years old, we weren't thinking about that so much as we were thinking about, I want to be somewhere cooler. It's a tough thing to...
Cooler.
But we talked about Toronto, Boston, San Francisco, Seattle, just because they seemed like cool places to be. I don't know what the solution to that is. We're still here, and we probably would have not succeeded in those cities. But how do I tell Colin from 4 years ago to stay in Rochester? I'm not sure the answer to that.
Before I go to Gahu, Senator Robach, and then Blake, and then anybody else that wants to respond. Then we're going to take some questions from the audience, if the audience would like to ask any questions of any of our panels. Not yet. As soon as we finish this round of questioning. Go ahead.
This is sort of a little more global, but I was just curious, you know, going on what Teresa said, we've all had opportunities to go and stay. I've looked at jobs, and I think it's different. My opportunities to move was when I had a family and children. And quite frankly, while the salaries are bigger in bigger cities and metropolitan areas, I was a little bit shocked coming from Rochester of what the cost of real estate was just to live or to even access water, golf, some of the things that I have come to love and maybe take for granted here in Rochester. But I don't think that young people, and from a business standpoint, that's really not a recruitment tool, the fantastic house you could get or to bring somebody in. I don't think that really works. Once you get them here, and I've dealt with a lot of people from all kinds of industries, once they come to Rochester, they seem to like it. But that was probably never really part of your thought process, right?
That wasn't part of it exactly. Yeah.
So we got to do a better job maybe of, because down the road, probably that's going to happen for most people.
We used to do it, and we would successfully recruit two or three engineers in from Silicon Valley every year.
Yeah.
We'd fly them in. We'd hand them to a real estate agent, drive them into a northern suburb of Buffalo, park them in front of a two-acre lot with a 3,000-square-foot home on it, and show them what the sale price was. And we would have about a 50% close rate. We would do this in July. I'm going to admit that. But we did it for a very specific reason. We were looking to bring specific types of talent, and we were looking to bring a different type of cultural attitude in to infect the kids that we had in the company that we'd hired locally. And it worked all the time. We would have, 1 year we had a guy with a $1.8 million mortgage. He flipped the house, bought a 7,000 square foot home in Amherst, and that was it.
Right. Well, yeah. And you're seeing people, even off of business now, coming from all over the country to buy properties in the Finger Lakes, which we think are expensive, they think is this tremendous bargain. I just wanted to offer one thing in the spirit of bipartisanship. If you're looking for excitement in Rochester, Senator O'Brien is an ambassador. You go out with him. Yeah. No one rips it up like this guy.
So,
but if I may throw in one thing, part of my job, I have to agree with what Colin said, and I'd like to go after that a little bit. Part of my job at Google involves acquiring companies and bringing them to move to California. It's currently my entire operation is based in Mountain View, and so if I acquire a company, it's required of them to relocate. And I have no problem getting companies in California to make this choice, but I've had great difficulty getting companies from New York, from Illinois, from overseas to relocate, because these people, they're home. They've got a home already. And you can't rip them out of that foundation that they've already started building for themselves. I think it's key to get companies like Collins to stay put for 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, get those roots in, and then they're much less likely to leave.
If I might say, what is the current downside to Westchester, where we're located, the high cost of living, the high cost of property, and the school districts, which are excellent, but they cost you a fortune, was also part of, if I may say, the longer-term plan for why we even kept it in Westchester instead of even going into the city, or maybe, it was actually talked about when Zephyr Games was started. Well, why not just go north? If we're going to keep it in New York City, go to somewhere with no rent, low rent, you know, do the whole thing. And that is currently a discussion. But if you keep it in Westchester, we do end up saying that our employees, because everyone's now, I mean, most of our freelancers are now getting married, talking about kids with their significant others, and it's a glimmer of a talk on the future. If we're going to stay there, if we get the property set up for the company, why not keep it in Westchester? Because then people have a 15-minute commute as opposed to a one-hour commute going into the city, because they're going to move there anyway for the school districts eventually. I'm sure that that's something that you guys use pretty solidly in your endeavor as well.
Indeed, except we, you know, you might have heard property taxes are pretty high in California. And, yeah. You know, I saw an advertisement here on campus for a three-bedroom, three-bath place for $650. And I can't even imagine a price like that in California. Unbelievable. And so, what I think there's a key point here then. There's got to be something that bridges that gap between when you leave the incubator and the next 4 or 5 years of being a company that keeps you from losing your employees and having the entire company move out of state. There's something magical that needs to be done there to really attract the people to stay.
We had that discussion last night, and I was setting up a 5-year contract, and if they left before, they would lose a benefit of the contract proportionately for the 5th year, 4th year, 3rd year, 2nd year. Something that we're definitely going to take a look at. Guha, how do I pronounce your first name again? I put it a third time.
Guha. Yeah.
Thank you.
Colin's experiences, you know, it's a very common one. And, I think beyond the business community, beyond the startup environment and incubators, for each of the metros that we have in New York, we have to kind of ask ourselves, what would it take to make that some kind of cultural mecca? This is sort of like a center of culture that makes it really fun, interesting place for a 20-year-old to 35-year-old to live, and hold ourselves to the highest possible standard for meeting that. So there's the kind of the company stage from 10 to 20 or 20 to 30, but then when you really have to scale for a lot of employees, that means getting them out of San Francisco, getting them out of Seattle or LA, or usually it's not a geography that big, it's Santa Monica and right in there. Or getting them right out of Mountain View, or getting them right out of the part that you don't get knifed in San Francisco, and that kind of thing. And we have to look at each community and say, how is that community going to be the best in the world to make that type of individual say, I can come here and I can live here, and it's going to be a lot of fun for me to live here. I can meet a spouse here, that kind of thing. And that's a lot of work, and it could take a lot of time. But Austin is the music capital of the country now. It wasn't 20 years ago. There was nothing there 20 years ago. We have areas in each of these communities that could be the seed for that. Saratoga Springs in New York is one of them, or in the capital region is one of them. There are other ones. There's the town of Pittsford, right around by the canal, right here in Rochester. And each community has, these types of areas that they could become unparalleled. And then you can add the other things, like you don't have to spend all your money on rent. But for a 20, 25-year-old, they don't care. I mean, the rent, they go and room with somebody else. Their only significant expense is gasoline, and that's as expensive here as it is in California. They don't have a house or property or kids to send to private school and all these things. So none of that stuff works. So scaling talent, like, for example, I was asked a few weeks ago, hey, Guha, what about moving to Austin? We'll just take the whole thing and move there. I refused to do that. But the reason why they say that is that it's a destination for talent. And Austin has, I think, 45 or 60 days of the year is above 100 degrees and humid. That's like the opposite climate of here. And it's not a particularly Mediterranean temperate climate. But it is a magnet for talent because it's also a cultural capital. So this is something that we should really think about. I think, with a concentrated effort over a 10 or 15-year period, each one of these major communities in New York could be as competitive as the best places, not only in the country, but also in the world, to attract that kind of talent.
Thank you very much. I'd like to announce that Senator Pat Gallivan has joined us, that we have some of the greatest representatives from upstate and from Rochester here, and I want to thank him, and he'll be here for the next forum, which will be starting in about an hour and 15 minutes. Blake. Why are we going to Microsoft, and how do you think you're going to be able to work with your team to go to your next step, and do you think you'll be able to do that?
Well, some of the reasons have already been mentioned. I mean, one of the things that's definitely there is that if like, I don't know, if I get fired from Microsoft or something, there's a lot of other companies around there. I don't really have to worry as much about, I have to worry about job security, but not to the extent as to here. If we started a company and that was the only thing we were doing and then that company went under, I don't exactly know what I would do without having to move, really. So that is definitely a major concern that we had. Whenever we were talking about where to place our company, it wasn't honestly Rochester. It was to move it to somewhere that would have more of a development that could support us already. We also found that we think that we can be successful currently by trying a model that isn't necessarily centered in office space. I mean, we're still planning on keeping our company relatively small and developing games kind of very independently, not as much necessarily geared towards a certain monetization model. So we think that even being separated wherever the rest of the team ends up, that we can still develop our games because of things like the internet, that we can communicate, that we don't need to be centered. And then hopefully one of our games will take off, and that is an avenue that we can pursue full-time and set up office space wherever we decide to.
So you would feel more comfortable if we had set up those types of hubs that we spoke of, getting anchor tenants in and setting up a 300-400 company group that would be around this anchor tenant, then that you would feel more comfortable staying here because you'd be able to move from position to position and different companies if you chose to do that, as well as be able to advance your own company within its incubator stages and as you advance that. Yes, Andy?
I wanted to make a point, too, as we're sort of talking about, you know, the idea of a cultural hub and what it takes to be a destination point for, you know, a young, affluent workforce and all of that. One of the things that I think RIT has been effective at in just the last couple of years, that in particular in the game space, that we may not have done such a great job of before, but when I spoke earlier about Magic being a bridge between campus into the community, we had a project a couple of years ago, Picture the Impossible, that was Liz Lawley's brainchild for kind of a gamified collaboration with the DNC, and it was a really great project. But one of the things we learned in that project was how much cultural history, how much activity, how much resource is available in Rochester, in the downtown area of Rochester, and how much the surrounding community doesn't even know what's here. So it was sort of an interesting kind of thing in that way. When we recruit faculty, to the School of IGM, we purposefully take them out to dinner downtown to prove to them that there is a downtown, right? Because you don't get that sense, right? People are not aware that this is, you know, actually a fairly large city, because it's not the portrayal of what folks get. We have some cultural resources, and in particular to the game space. I mean, JP's sitting here from the National Museum of Play. They have things in that archive, right, that make every game design and development professional, their jaw hits the floor when they see the things that they have access to and the resources available at an institution like that. But, you know, getting the word out that those things are here, I mean, that's kind of a part of what we're talking about when we talk about building a community around development within this space. It also means capitalizing on the things we do have and in turn recognizing them and making sure that those are well-promoted resources to folks looking to come into the region.
Thank you, Andy. Colin, you had something?
I wanted to say real quick that just yesterday, one of our employees came into work that we hired directly from RIT. She's been with us for over a year or something like that. And she comes in and she goes, "Did you know there's a waterfall in Rochester?" Because I think to what you're saying, when you're in Henrietta at RIT, sometimes you just don't make it downtown and you don't see what's there. And
you don't understand what it is to live here,
right,
in the way that those of us that have lived here a while do.
Yep. Right.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We'll take some questions from the audience.
Hello? Oh. Hi, I'm Michelle Yazer. I work for Adobe, and actually I live in Boston, city proper. And what becomes interesting, I'm also involved in the game circle for the MIT Enterprise Forum, and I'm a mentor for MassDigi, which is the state of Massachusetts, one of their big programs. that you guys are competing with. And I've heard all of this for the past year and a half in Massachusetts. The brain drain. We lose our students to San Francisco, Austin, and Seattle. And the reason for that is because they're much hipper cities than Boston. The music and club scene in Boston is not what it was in the 70s and 80s at its height. Most of the places that the 20s and into the early 30s-somethings want to go out at night have been replaced by big national chains and things like that. A local company that was working on recruiting tried to impress people with the Boston Symphony Orchestra and the Boston Ballet, which are certainly top in the world, but at that age, it's not what they're interested in. And so being a cultural center is really important to talent, but you have to make sure it's the right culture. I love Saratoga Springs. It's the home of the New York City Ballet. I'm there every summer. It's fantastic. I'm not 20 anymore. And that's not where I was going in my 20s or my 30s as a young developer. One of the other just points to make, the Innovation Center in Kendall Square, the reason that it works so well is that there are legal people in the building, there are accountants in the building, HR services that are all shared. That specialize in software and gaming development for those incubators. And it's a community. It's exactly what, Toby was talking about, that you bump into people at the water cooler, the elevator, and things like that. I've had a number of friends who've launched successful businesses from that building over the years. But they also do community outreach, where businesses are there. They have weekly events, and they have monthly events that bring businesses who are already successful into that space to share knowledge. It's not about the money, it's about knowledge, because in spite of what you may heard, at least what the gaming companies in Boston say, there is no VC in Boston. They all want biotech. If you don't have bio something in your name, you aren't gonna get a time in front of one of the main VCs in Boston. So the grass isn't always greener, just a second.
Thank you. That's good to hear, by the way.
Hi, I'm Steve Jacobs. I'm an associate director of the Magic Center, and I'm a professor here. I wanted to follow up on some of what Toby said, which also goes back to what other people have said here. When I go to the Game Developers Conference or I go to some of the other industry events, I can see pavilions from Ireland, the Netherlands, Germany, California, state after state. You know, as you guys have done with the Film Bureau in Rochester, right? And the Film Bureau, they're not only in Rochester, but in New York City, right? They're out there selling the state as a location for shooting, selling the state as come do it cheaper here because we have all the tech here. Those kinds of promotions, those kinds of pavilions at industry conferences go miles to getting people to actually take you seriously, to actually find out that there's a waterfall in Rochester. You know, those kinds of things are huge. And Toby and we and other folks in the state have been saying, gosh, we really need one of those. And we'll talk to Lee and his people about doing that. Individually, we can't put that together. But it's a great opportunity for the state to help us build that center of gravity around which something like that can happen, that the smaller companies don't have to pay $2,000 for the 10-foot square piece of concrete, plus the money for the power, plus the money for the booth, plus the plus, the plus, the plus, because they're already going to send their people out to California for a week, and airfare, and, you know, dollars for hotel and food. You know, we have the same issue with our students. We'd love to be able to take every student out to the Game Developers Conference and help them show off their skills, and we do as much as we can as an individual college. Take a booth there, show what our kids can do. And that's what gets us the partnerships. That's what gets us the participation. So it's really key to take a look at that and see how you can leverage that kind of opportunity.
We'll take one more question from the audience. Go ahead. That'll be you. Yes, ma'am. We're going to have a probably a 15-minute break right after this question. Then we're going to go to a working lunch at 12 o'clock, and there'll be presentations and conversations will continue into the afternoon.
Great. Now I'm between you and lunch. So this is a potentially more of a recommendation than a question. I'm Allison Bryant from Play Collective, and we are downstate. Following up on the GDC conversation, and maybe something that is not it's a different approach into this, is, and thinking a bit larger about the games industry, and something that we haven't seen a lot of, is support for women-owned gaming companies or minority-owned gaming companies. And if you're thinking about how New York could potentially have some differentiating space, thinking about tax incentives and ways to bring in those companies, which also may potentially be more likely to take advantage of the B Corporation, things that have been going on here, just a different bit of a frame, but also a differentiator that could bring in some real innovation that we haven't necessarily seen in other places.
Thank you very much. On the dais, is there any question that was brought up as the speakers from the audience? Did anything strike you that you wanted to respond to? If not, we'll have that break. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, everyone.